Clean screen scenes. First, a bit of history, and then we'll go to scene one, which is called tolerance. This just gives you an idea of my living room. It just shows you four screens that I want to give a bit of history about, and I've set them up here just to show you what they're all about. The one in the front is a 4-foot screen. Behind it is a 6-foot screen, behind it is an 8-foot screen, and behind it is my presently being used 12-foot screen. That's horizontal, that's not diagonal, that's horizontal dimension. So that really bright thing in the front is a screen that I had probably in about 1950 something or other when I was using an 8mm camera, and that was a screen. It is a lenticular screen, which is really bright. The screen right behind it is another lenticular, which I purchased probably about 1970 or so when I got my first SLR camera, an analog film camera, but I wanted a bigger screen that I could show the 35mm slides better. And then when I finally went to digital, and this one is also lenticular, by the way, and then finally when I went to digital cameras, say 1996 thereabouts, I got this 8-foot screen that's probably the best screen I've ever owned. The mechanism isn't very good, but the screen is wonderful, and it has lasted since then to now. I still use it. It's a portable screen. When I give lectures at various and sundry nursing homes and so forth and so on, I take the screen along with me as well as my portable projector, and it does a wonderful job. However, I decided that putting up an 8-foot screen whenever I wanted to watch a movie in my so-called home theater was kind of a pain in the butt, so I installed a 12-foot wide screen that's mounted to the ceiling, and that's the screen we're going to talk about in this particular conversation. Interesting view from the side. You will notice that the lens particular screen, which was the brightest from the front, ends up being totally dark from the side, and that's because the lenticulars are lenses that actually focus the light, and both lenticular screens are very dark from this angle. Once again, my favorite screen is just nice and bright from the front, from the side, no matter where from, and the currently screen that I have is this one, which is not as bright, but it's pretty uniform side to side and from the front. And I just thought that this was really quite interesting to see how the lenticular screen is so bright from the front and is so dark when looked at off-axis a little bit. What we're going to talk about is a problem that I was having with my principal large 12-foot screen, and that's the problem called hotspot. And this is a sort of an artistic, I never took a picture of one of my hotspots, but this is an artistic rendering of what a hotspot looks like. It is a bright spot on the screen, and there are defects in it. Some of them are linear, some of them are spots. And these kinds of spots occur when the screen gets weird. The location of these hotspots is totally dependent on the observer. This is an illustration. If you have the projector indicated where it is on the screen, the projector will fill the screen, which you can see at the top, but the observer one sees a hot spot at an equal angle location from the projector, and observer two will see a hot spot at a different point of the screen, also at an equal angle location. And obviously somebody who's sitting right under or near the projector will see a hot spot sort of in the middle of the screen. The black spots that I showed you in the suggested hot spot, they will be different here because the black spots are defects on the surface of the screen caused by dust, insects, and other contaminants. Here is an illustration of hotspots. You will see a hotspot. You all see the hotspot?
Mm-hmm.
And that is the sort of thing that happens, and it started off 2 or 3 years ago, and it just kept getting progressively worse. I would invite nice people and objectionable people over to my house, to watch movies and stuff. And occasionally the objectionable people would say to me, that looks like crap. That's the hot spot there. That's terrible. And one of the objectionable, maybe two of the objectionable people are in this room right now, but I won't say who they are. Anyway, the nice people didn't say anything, but I talked to them later and they said, yeah, they saw it too, but didn't want to say anything. So I, you know, and I didn't like it. So I got to thinking to myself, what can we do to solve this problem? I went online, and lo and behold, projection screens, some of them do have this problem. Interestingly enough, that one screen that I said was my favorite one, the 8-footer that's portable, it's almost 20 years old now, has never had a hotspot problem. But my current screen, the 12-foot wide one, it's a daylight screen. And I called the daylight people, and they denied that they ever have a hotspot problem. When I purchased this screen about 5 years ago, I tried to actually get it from the people who did my favorite screen. The top of the screen needs to have about 2.5 feet of black so that the screen lowers down so that you don't have to crane your neck to see the screen way up in the air. I wanted to lower the screen, and only the daylight people would put a 2.5 foot black patch at the top of the screen for me at that time. So that's why I went with them. So scene one is tolerance. I tolerated for a number of years. Finally, had objectionable people complain bitterly to me about it. So I decided I would try scene two, which was let's wash the screen with soap and water. Now, the instructions for the screen say,
don't wash the screen.
Or if you do, do it very gently. So I did it very gently and it did nothing. So I did it a little bit more vigorously, and that managed to make the black spots worse. It did nothing at all for the bright spot. So scene two didn't work. It was a disappointment. So scene three, let's replace the whole screen. Now, there are people in our organization, Earl Geddes among them, who advocates bed sheets as a being excellent screen material. And I've heard the same thing, and bed sheets seem like a good idea. Now, my screen is 12 feet wide. Well, it turns out that I did some shopping, and here are some people who market a 12-foot wide bed, and they sell sheets as well as mattresses. So their sheets are 144 inches wide and are 90 inches high, the Ace family size. Wonderful. Yes, yes. Okay, let's think about doing that. So I went online, I went to their company, and I found out about their sheets. And you can see what the problem with their sheets is. So I said, well, there must be another choice. Went to Amazon, and I found a tablecloth. The proper dimensions, and you can see the price. $18. Wowzers. I bought one. I have it. It's out in the foyer as we speak. Anybody who wants it can negotiate with me for it. It actually works pretty well. It's not as good as a bed sheet because it's a little more coarse. In my application, 1080p projections work perfectly. It really looked very, very good. I really wanted a screen capable of 4K, and I think that even in my application, 4K probably would not have worked. But 1080p at reasonable distance away worked very well. This is an early attempt. I taped it to the bottom of my screen, raised it up. This is what it looks like. It's a nice, beautiful white color. This is before I figured out that I needed to iron this thing to get all the creases out. That worked. I needed to figure out a way to stretch it. That was hard, but I got that sort of to work, and I managed to see some movies on the screen this way. It worked really very well. I was just about in the process of thinking about actually replacing the screen with something like this, but then I remembered, in order to do that, I have to take this thing down from the ceiling, and then I've got to take the screen out, put this stuff inside, and then I've got to call somebody to put this thing back up. This thing on the ceiling weighs 150 pounds. I had three people come in and install it for me 5 years ago, and I looked up to see what their installation fee was, and I remembered now their installation fee was that, and I would need to have them come twice, once to take it down and once to put it back up again. So I said to myself, well, let's see if there's anything else we can do. So I've got a tablecloth out there. If anybody wants to use a tablecloth as a huge screen, it'll work just fine for 1080p. So what else to do? I shopped around and looked, and lo and behold, now we're at scene four. There is a company that makes screen paint. This is a paint designed for painting on solid walls, plaster walls, if you will. They've got excellent specifications. The price is right. The color is right. I mean, if you've got a plaster wall that you think might be a good wall for a screen, I would say this should be excellent stuff to use. I wrote him a letter and explained what my situation was. And he said, Dear Bernhard, I'm afraid that our paint will not work very well if it's rolled up and down a lot. The hot spot you are experiencing, and I disagree with him on this, is not caused by the 1.1 gain, but by the screen being not flat. Our paint has a 1.5 gain rating, but no problem with hot spots. I would suggest going to Home Depot and buy a quart of Bern Ultra Pure White Premium Plus wall paint in a flat sheen. This paint will have a gain of about 1.2. One coat will cure your hot spot problem and will probably last for at least a year with the rolling up and down before cracks appear. Clearly, his paint is more rigid and will probably crack right away, and that explains his first sentence. Good luck with your screen. I appreciated his commentary and his suggestion and his advice, so I went to Home Depot and I bought a $2 color sample of exactly the paint that he recommended. I also purchased a window shade to experiment. So I took the right side, this side of the window shade, and painted it with that paint. And you can see that it was painted. I was a little bit distressed by the irregularity because I used a paintbrush. I subsequently painted the other side with a paint roller, and that was much more uniform. But when I had the paint on just this half of the screen, I let it dry for a couple of days, and then I rolled the screen up and down about 100 times just to test to see whether there would be any cracking. There wasn't. It worked just fine, except the shade went up irregularly, unevenly, because it was twice as thick on the painted side as it was on the unpainted side, so it didn't roll up properly. So that caused me to worry. If the screen is twice as thick, will there be room for all of that stuff up there in my housing? Oh dear. Some worries. So what I did, I took this paint, which, as I said, worked perfectly well on this window shade, and I projected some images on this, and it looked great. It looked really well. I took the lower corner of my big screen, and I painted maybe 4 or 6, 8 square inches on both lower corners. I did one with the brush and one with the roller. Painted those lower corners just to see how it would work out. And I waited 24, 48 hours until it was dried. And everything looked okay. And then I rolled up the screen. And I had some other stuff I had to attend to. The following day, I went back and attempted to look at my screen.
Ooh!
I pushed the button, and the motor went whoop, and nothing happened. I stopped it instantly. And then I went up there, and fortunately, I've got access to one side of the screen. And it turns out that the 4 square inches, which had been painted, were the best sticky glue I have ever seen. I managed to separate them, and the screen finally eventually came down. And then I looked carefully at those two lower corners, and they were really, really, really sticky. Clearly, the chemical stuff that was causing the hot spot effect was also interacting with the paint changing the paint from a nice solid stuff that worked well in the window shade to something that was sticky and gooey and would just be a disaster if I had painted it on the whole screen. Oh dear. Well, first of all, I need to get rid of this paint that's in the lower corners of my screen before I do anything else. How do you get rid of non-water soluble paint, regular paint? I wasn't sure, so I went to scene 5, and I went to the Ace Hardware store and I bought some solvents. These are all the solvents that they had, and they range all the way from pretty mild to pretty severe stuff. Yes. One of the things I didn't want to do was dissolve my whole screen or dissolve the matrix that, you know. So I started with this stuff here, the odorless mineral spirits, and I started to scrub the lower corners, the 6 square inches. And lo and behold, with this stuff and a little bit of excess scrubbing, I was able to get rid of the paint. Oh. And then I turned on my projector and I looked at the screen. Hey, those 2 corners that I scrubbed don't have any hot spots. Yeah, no hot spots there. Son of a gun. Maybe if I tried scrubbing the whole damn screen with this stuff, I can get rid of my hot spots.
Which one did you use?
Well, I used this one, which is odorless mineral spirits. This is the stuff that when you shake it, you're supposed to shake it thoroughly, it turns into white stuff. There is a soluble white stuff in there that makes it odorless. I don't know how that works. Well, so I started with a little patch to keep the screen from bouncing against the wall. As you can see, the screen has been pulled away from the wall. I've got the screen pulled away from the wall by about 1 foot so that I can scrub it. I use some tools. I've got a tool that applies the stuff. I've got a tool that then scrubs the stuff off. And I've got about 1,000 microfiber cloths that I got from Costco at reasonable cost. And I take these cloths and I apply them to these things and put them on with clamps so that they're on there. The process that you will see on the next slide evolved over the period of weeks. And I started with steps 1 and 2. And when that didn't work, I had to add steps 3 and 4. And when that didn't work, I had to add steps 5 and 6 and so forth. So here is the procedure. The stuff with the white stuff in it, very clearly, very early on, proved not really to work properly. So this is the stuff that I started with, and I then went to the next mild stuff, which was standard paint thinner, and that's the stuff I ended up with, and I continued to use. The xylene, the acetone, and the kerosene I never had to go to. So I've got those as spares in my basement. If you want to buy some kerosene from me, I'll be happy to sell you 1,000 gallons. The procedure: attach a cloth to both applicators. Add a second cloth to the dry applicator. Thoroughly wet the solvent applicator cloth with the solvent, with the clear paint cleaner. Apply the solvent to a 2 by 4 foot area. If you apply it to a larger area, it doesn't work. Small area. Wait a few minutes. Then use the dry applicator to remove the excess solvent from that patch. Change the cloth with a clean dry cloth and gently rub the entire 2 by 4 foot region with a 6-inch overlap to the surrounding areas, tapering the scrubbing. Because if you don't do that, then you will see edges from the 2 by 4. If you do something larger than 2 by 4, there's too much garbage left on the screen, it looks like shit. So you've got to stick with a small area at a time. So you taper the edges to get rid of the edges of your 2 by 4 area. Then you inspect your work under bright light. preferably using your projector. I didn't. I used a spotlight so I didn't use up my projector bulb. The spotlight is much cheaper. That worked. If the edges can be seen of your little area, remove them with the clean cloth. Try scrubbing a little bit more. If that doesn't work, then you got to do that whole 2x4 patch all over again. If that does work and you can see that the patch is nice and clear and there are no edges to be seen, then you wash all of the used cloths in your washing machine and you start over again on another 2x4 foot patch. Do 2x4 foot patches until your entire 12x9 screen has been done. And that's what I did. And I think there are people here who will attest to the fact that it pretty much worked.
It works.
Yeah. Not just the front of the screen, you got to do the back of the screen as well, because it's very clear early on. If I did the front of the screen and then rolled up the screen, and a couple days later brought the screen back down, it was just as bad as it was before because it got the chemical from the back of the screen as well. So I have to just scrub the back of the screen as well. But you don't have to scrub the back of the screen as meticulously. Because the back of the screen, if there's some edges, it doesn't matter much. But you have to scrub both sides.
And you don't roll it up until you do both sides.
Correct. You got it. So anyway, so that's basically it. And any questions? No. Okay, so anytime you want a 12x9 screen, let me know. I will help you with its management.
What is your distance from the screen that you watch?
20 feet.
20 feet?
Yeah. Well, 15 to 20 feet, yeah.
The hotspot will be there no matter what distance you look at it?
Yeah.
Right. Same place or move around?
It depends on where you're sitting. From where you're sitting, it's always an equal angle from the projector. But it'll always be in the same spot if you're sitting in the same spot. If you move to a different spot, then it'll be a different spot on the screen.
You're trying to make a hot screen, but it didn't work real good.
Well, when the screen was brand new, it didn't do that. That slowly evolved with time, and that was my stage one. Scene one was tolerance. That is to say, it's not so bad, I can live with it. Until it got to the point where even my friends were complaining. Well, they used to be
objectionable
my
ones.
They used to be my friends, you know.
You didn't mention the spots came from spiders getting squished when you're.
Oh yeah, well that was a.
Oh, I don't.
Do that. Spider spots.
I found them much more distracting than the hot spot.
This program has been a production of the Southeastern Michigan Woofer and Tweeter Marching Society. Opinions expressed during this program are those of the individual speaking and not necessarily the opinion of the Southeastern Michigan Woofer and Tweeter Marching Society.